Hey, you lovely lot. This is our final video. This is the bike video. So because it's above my pay grade, we know that I've brought in Jimmy, our bike expert. And as a special treat, if you're just watching the bike video, we've both got our shorts on because a lot of people have been writing in asking to see your calves.
So who's got the best legs? Comment who's got the nicest legs.
Will you go to the gym? I've never been to the gym in 50 years of being alive.
Doesn't show.
Thanks, man. Anyway, let's start with this. Talking of muscular and well-proportioned, this is the 1954 Norton Model 7. Tell me about this bike. This is a lovely older restoration, isn't it?
Yes, it is. So this one's a Model 18. And as you can see, it's been restored to a really good standard. Previous restoration, though, before the current owner.
Yeah.
You can say that, like, the seat here, the original rider seat is original. However, the one on the rear has been replaced, so it's probably seen a little bit of wear. And in general, it's in very good condition. Bike runs,
yeah.
Everything else is VAT exempt, I was going to say, tax exempt, MOT exempt, and just needs a new owner.
Basically. It's nice, it's a bit of recommissioning to get that going. Yeah. I love, with cars or bikes, I love older restorations because you know what you're getting, don't you?
That's right.
Anything that's going to have come through or anything that's going to have cracked, any paint that's going to have settled will have happened by now. So
yeah, certainly, so you know what you're getting.
What do you reckon, 45 grand get you that, do you reckon?
Yeah, potentially, yeah.
So there you go.
See what happens on the day.
Rather nice. So moving on to this, the Model 7.
Model 7, yeah.
So tell me about this. So obviously this is a little bit more patinaized, this one, a bit more patinated.
Yeah, so actually this is in a previous restoration. This was fully restored at some point. And the current owner has had the bike for a long, long time. So as you can see, it would benefit from some further restoration. However, there isn't any damage to the tank, the chassis, the wheels, anything else. And it's been restored with most of its originality as well.
So that was restored a long time ago, I would say.
Yeah, so it's 20, 30 years ago, I would say.
I would leave that, you know. I would just leave it and enjoy it as it is. Just get it road legal and running. How long do you reckon to get that up and running again?
To have it up and running, it runs.
Oh, okay.
Just to recommission, the bike runs. So that would only take you a weekend.
Quick service, get your brakes sorted,
yeah.
And away you go.
Yeah.
So tell us about this rather beautiful bike. This is a 1954 BSA C11G.
Yeah, a stunning bike. Again, another restoration. You can see this one's been done to a really good standard. And I believe the reserve on this one is actually quite low, the estimate on this
one. 2 to 3 grand, mate, you could buy this one.
2 to 3 thousand. So with a bottom end estimate of 2 thousand, that is ultimately a really cheap way into a British-made classic motorcycle.
And really pretty as well, aren't they? Beautiful style this year. I really like the full mudguard as well. That's nice.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, the only real difference to anyone who would know about this bike is that this seat has actually been changed. The original one had a slightly higher camber to it for a pillion passenger, which sticks the feet on the pegs there. Other than that, it's pretty much original.
And then sticking with all these lovely British bikes, around to this Norton Model 50.
Yep.
Again, a really handsome bike there, isn't it?
It is a handsome bike.
The 1953, but looks, that's a very stylish bike for its time. That to me looks like it was kind of ahead of its ahead of its design period, that.
Yeah, it looks quite full, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. A butch bike.
Machine. Handles very well, rides nice, with just 3.5 at the bottom end of the estimate as well. Again, that's another, just like the BSA, really cheap way. And the Model 50, just for the reasons that you've just stated, makes it quite a collectible machine, quite a popular bike.
Yeah. But that's the thing, that's what really surprises me about all these bikes, is how much fun you can have, what a beautiful bike you can get that doesn't need an awful lot of work. But you know, in car terms, relatively tiny amounts of cash. So that you can either just stick it in the corner of your man cave or your she shed, you can restore it, you can ride it, you can just collect them. They don't take up any room, do they?
And they don't cost you anything as well.
No.
Which is the other bonus.
Now tell me about this beautiful 1962 AGS Model 31 CSR.
Yep.
That's gorgeous as well.
So it is gorgeous. It's been restored in its original colours, again, to a really high standard. It does need a little bit of tidying up, but nothing major at all. It's been restored, so the motor, to be honest, if you look at the mileage, it's barely been bedded in. And again, it's got a low reserve. The owner has just actually done a full service on this bike as well, and it runs perfectly.
Brilliant, because that's only done just over 200 miles since it was restored, hasn't it?
That's so right, yeah.
You can just shake that down and have effectively a brand new bike. And we've estimated that at 4 to 5 grand, which you couldn't restore it for that, could you?
No. I mean, at 4 or 5 to 5 grand, if you get it for that, you've stole it.
You've nicked it. We love that. Right, 1928 Norton CS1. This looks like it was a bit of a speed machine back in its day. Tell me the story of this bike. So 1928 production race bike.
It is, 1928 production race bike. If you were anyone who was anyone, and you know about these sort of classic stuff, that was the bike to have. Bike's capable of doing 98 miles an hour even to this day. It starts up off a roller starter.
Oh, does it really?
It sounds absolutely incredible. Yeah, yeah. So it's like a full-on race bike almost, with a very, very early version of a full race ignition back in the 1920s.
Love the frame. Is it hardtail frame, is it?
It's hardtail frame.
The sprung saddle?
Yeah, just a sprung saddle to protect your monkeys and parrots.
That is a great looking thing. And you could buy that off. So obviously that's not a cheap item because of what it is. Very rare bike.
No, but a realistic reserve.
29 to 31.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I know that the current owner paid quite a lot of money for this bike, so he needs to recuperate what he can, but I can envisage this going for a decent amount of money, but enough that someone can buy something to either move on, or they can own it for a while and sell it.
Yeah.
You know, we're definitely not going to lose any money on it.
Love that. Now, moving on to this incredible stuff. We like the genuine race machinery here, and this is an incredible replica of this. If this was real, obviously what we're looking at here, this 67 Suzuki RT67 GP125 evocation, if that was real, what would that cost?
Yeah, I mean, so the original RT, they only actually made 12, but three for production racing. So you're looking at tens of thousands of pounds, depending on what the individual was willing to pay.
And these were, just for the layman like me, these were made just for competing, weren't they, at Isle of Man? That was just very singular purpose. Bike
in road racing, exactly. Yeah, so what you're effectively looking at is a full manufacturer's standard race replica of the rarest race bike in the world,
probably for about a tenth of what a real one would cost.
Well, yeah, probably less.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah, exactly.
And if you just want something just to show off and have a bit of fun with, if you've got like a restaurant or a pub, or I say just a really cool space that you want to show something off.
Yeah.
To put something up that looks like a 30, 40 grand bike for, what, two or three grand maybe?
Yeah, or ironically, if you can find a class for it, you could race it because it works.
Ah. Yeah. Because I guess a real one's probably too valuable to race, isn't it? Because you wouldn't want to put it down.
Well, you'd be scared to death, wouldn't you? So, but yeah, I mean, I've rode that. There's a video on Facebook. Me and Elliot took it out and had a bit of a laugh riding it around the car park. So it absolutely works. I can remember burning the inside of my leg on the exhaust. That you can see.
You should have put your skin tight jeans on.
Yeah, I know, but it's the summer, isn't it?
So from a race bike replica to the real deal. So behind that is a lovely 76 Yamaha.
Yep.
So this is the Flying Chef's own personal machine, this, isn't it? This
correct,
has
yeah.
genuine TT creds, that one.
Yeah, so finished ninth in the TT in 1976-1977. And that bike is 100% on the button, apart from the swing arm. The swing arm is a full race spec swing arm.
Yeah.
So if you were to take that off and replace it with the original one,
then it would be,
you could cash in big time on that swing arm.
Oh really?
Yeah. 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 And again, low estimate on that one. And it's a real collector's piece.
Because like I say, that's no evocation, that's no replica, that's the real deal, doesn't it? The clipping beneath it, that is the Flying Chef in action on his bike.
Yep.
So if you want something that's been there, done that, got the T-shirt, there's your bike.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
There's something else that looks like it's done a few track miles in its time, is this absolute beast. So this Yamaha R1, the fact we've got a whole pile of optional sprockets here for gearing for different tracks and some saucy wheels and tyres, this is clearly somebody's track pride and joy, this, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we know the vendor of this bike. It's got some lightweight Merch and Easy wheels on there. They're the red standard wheels you can see on the floor with the cut slicks. It's got a set of race wets on it at the minute. And that is a Yamaha, and the model is a 4XV. So that was the first generation of the 1000cc Yamaha R1. So it was the one that everybody wants. They called it the coffin filler because it's just ultimate power.
Yeah.
That one's been tricked out with some Maxton suspension all the way around, Maxton damper, some AVS levers. It's got a really nice Logitech quick shifter on there as well. So it's full race spec, full race ignition.
What would that cost to build? Because the estimate on this is 1500 to 2.5 grand, which to me seems like an utter bargain.
Because
if you were just to quickly top that up and build that on a decent base bike, what would that stand you at?
Well, at the bottom end of 1400 of the estimate, that wouldn't even buy you the suspension.
It's mad, isn't it? Somebody's going to get an utter bargain there.
Yeah, if someone buys that and they're looking for a way into track racing, that's the perfect way to do it, because you wouldn't be scared of throwing it down the road
if
it happens, but you are getting something that's absolutely top spec for not a lot of money, and also it's got a full race exhaust and air filter system on it as well.
What a bargain, real bargain for someone. Then onto something less brutal, but no less pretty. Yep. 1985 Suzuki GP100, fully restored Super Sport. What a lovely thing that is.
It is beautiful, really popular. And while we're here, we'll just cover both, because these have come from the same vendor. If Elliot just has a look over there, you see lot 5 and lot 13. And they're both GP100s, both from the same vendor. One arguably restored to a slightly higher standard than the other. However, both equally priced. I'm worth roughly around the same money.
Right, and then a bookend in this amazing, which to be honest, you have me at Rothmans livery, this CBR.
Yeah.
Now, I know that's obviously like an aftermarket livery, but that looks so good, doesn't it?
Of course, yeah, it's beautiful. I mean, it's a CBR 400RR. It's got an NS250RR kit on there. However, that's because they don't make a Rothmans livery for the CBR 400. So it fits well. It's proper job. The bike is a good bike, it's low mileage, it's been well maintained, there's plenty of history and stuff with it. Yeah, and it looks beautiful.
And $3,000 to $4,000 could buy that, couldn't it? Yeah. Realistically, plus your commissions. But again, you could turn up at any meeting with that, I reckon you get some attention, don't you?
Yeah, it's a beautiful thing, yeah.
Now, are you humming the theme to James Bond in your head at the moment? Because we're about to turn around and look at this. The 1999 BMW R1200C. Now, even me with my meagre bike knowledge knows that's a bit special. The stunt bike that was used in, well, what looked like the stunt bike used in the James Bond films.
Slightly browner version.
Yeah. But they are a very cool looking machine, aren't they?
Very solid, very robust. Once the bike's actually moving, very solid grounded bike.
Yeah.
Easy to handle and effortless to ride, especially with that huge screen on the front. You don't get any wind in, well, I don't get wind in my hair anyway. You wouldn't get any wind in your hair. Absolute pleasure to ride. Loads of bottom end integral torque on these. That's what they're built for, not really horsepower. And yeah, just
huge touring torque.
Yeah, and obviously it's a BMW, so they don't mess about. You get full Brembo setups.
Yeah.
You get better suspension and everything else, everything that's to be expected on a BMW.
But they just look so good. I was at the BMW Museum a few weeks ago in Germany, and they have obviously one of those. They have an example of all their best bikes in there, and they had one of those in there. Just an incredible looking thing. Nothing is styled quite like a BMW, is it?
Not really, no. But BMWs use quality, don't they, straight away.
And that's $7,000 to $8,000, you could buy that. You could do your own James Bond chase scene for $7,000 to $8,000. Mm-hmm. Just super comfortable. I sat on that earlier. If you're a big lad or lass, that's just, you could do miles on that, couldn't you? Miles and miles.
Yeah, absolutely. Like I was saying, it's effortless to ride and very comfortable. As well as for your pillion passenger as well on the back.
In keeping with the cruising theme, 2005 Harley Softail Cruiser.
Mm.
So what's that all about then? So Springer, so an example of an American icon. I love that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, this is one of, like I've said about the BMW, one of the easier Harley Davidsons to ride. I don't know if you've ever rode a Harley Davidson, but you're pretty much stretched out, even if you're a pretty tall bloke. These Springers are a little bit easier to ride and a little bit softer on the back end. This one, again, great example. Low mileage for its year, and as you can see, Elliot's probably showing you there the quality of the finish and stuff on the bike.
So how much of that is standard, how much of that is option?
To be honest, at first look, you can see the air filter that's sticking out.
I was going to say, that cannot be factory standard.
No, they generally have what looks like a small panel filter that's on the side. That's an adaptation, so that's an aftermarket part. Other than that, apart from the leather satchel on the front, it's pretty much all there and pretty much how it was when it left the factory.
Very nice looking thing. What would buy you that, do you reckon, on the day?
Who knows? I mean, it's probably worth, you know, 7,000 to 8,000 at the top end.
Fabulous looking machine.
Yeah.
A little bit smaller, a little bit better off-road. We've got this 1965 BSA Bantam. Really nicely restored, this one, I guess, an older restoration that it sat in for a little while. Beautiful looking thing. Such a nicely proportioned bike, that, isn't it?
It is a nicely proportioned bike, yeah. I mean, as I put in the description, it's a full conversion, so if anyone's watching this thinking, that's not a BSA Bantam. Yes, it looks nothing like a BSA Bantam.
Yeah.
It's been completely changed and tricked to work as a trials bike, but that's not uncommon for people to do that with a Bantam of that era, because they just do it so well.
Yeah. Well, it looks like it was supposed to be a trials frame, doesn't it, when you see it converted like that?
Yeah,
when was that done then? Do you know, just sometime in ancient history?
Sometime in ancient history, yeah. Definitely not by the gentleman that owns it now.
Yeah.
But it's nicely finished as well. I mean, that exhaust on the back there, that end cam, that's actually a play on the original BSA Bantam's exhaust that's been cut. So although, you know, if you didn't know BSA Bantam, you might not recognise it. It's actually been quite nicely done that.
So fully custom, but really sort of in keeping and commensurate with what people were doing in period.
Yeah,
I love that. It's very, very nice. Now this is for the resto purists. This is one to kind of drink in, isn't it, in terms of the time and the effort and the money. I mean, just talk about the part story on this Husqvarna. This is an 82, isn't it, this?
Yeah.
And this is pretty much, someone's gone for museum quality Concours here, haven't they?
Yeah, I mean, when you talk about restoring bikes, trials bikes, that's pretty much the pinnacle there that you're looking at. It doesn't really get any better than that. And the beauty is that the actual vendor of this bike has restored it, and all the parts, including the exhaust system, the works, the wheels, the suspension, are all Husqvarna parts. They're all
genuine OE.
Manufactured parts, completely OE.
But it's had everything you can see, hasn't it? But then it's all the stuff you can't see. So it's had obviously the forks re-chromed, but then it's had the main and small end bearings, piston rings, barrel head, carbs been sonic clean, the tank's been professionally painted, and that is beautiful. I've done that.
It is beautiful.
All new plastics. I mean, that is a brand new bike, isn't it, basically?
It's just a new bike, yeah. It's just a new for old motorcycle.
Is it too nice to use almost? Is it like, that's a treasure piece in your collection, isn't it? That you wouldn't want to get that on the trail, would you?
It's 100% collector's piece, but if you're an avid trials bike rider and you're not scared of a bit of dirt,
yeah,
you know, that would be a shed load of fun.
It is, it's an incredible restoration. The work that's gone into this, I'm just having a look now, it's unreal. The detail and the perfection.
Yeah.
Like every link on the chain is just so clean. It's so clinical, isn't it? It's any word to use.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I really like the way he's had the wheels anodized as well to match the matte anodized forks.
Yeah.
Again, that was how it was produced from the factory. So
a lot of money's gone into that. And if you were going to try and tuck that away in your collection, you'd need to dig a bit deeper, for that, wouldn't you? I'd imagine.
You'd need to dig a little bit deeper. But the thing is, it's probably worth between 16,000 and 17,000 resale, and it's got a lovely low end estimate on it of 12.5 to 13.5. So.
I bet there's more than that of parts in it, isn't there?
Well, yeah. The vendor's not done it for the money.
Yeah.
Put it that way.
You want this 82 Yamaha? This is lovely. Tell me about this. This is obviously a little bit more careworn, this one. This has had a life, hasn't it? This has been enjoyed.
So that's had a life, and I know it's had a life because the gentleman that imported the bike, it's still on a V55 American import.
Oh, is it? Right, yeah.
He's actually used it a number of times. It looks a little bit rough on the surface, you know, it needs a little bit of work doing to it, but mechanically the bike is great. He's took it out blasting on his local fields and everything else with his friends and whatever, and enjoyed some moments on it. So it works, it's faultless. Does it need tidying up? Yes.
Well, just use it.
Yeah, exactly. If you're not bothered about the aesthetics and you just want it to have some fun on it, then yeah.
It's mad, isn't it? So both those bikes they made, they're both 41 years old. There's an example of, you know, money no object restoration.
Yes.
And something that's lived in its skin. Yeah. But you could buy that, what, for $2,000-$2,500 probably?
Yeah.
That?
Yeah.
Yeah. Amazing. Two ends of the spectrum there, depending on what your budget is or what your aspiration is. This is lovely, this gas as well. Yeah. I remember watching all the trials programmes, early noughties. Everybody was on these, weren't they?
Yeah, I mean, this is not something you'd want to use to commute to work on.
No. There's no seat for starters.
There's no seat for starters, so it'll be quite a painful journey. So that is a gas XTX 250, so it's a 2002, as it says, and it is a full trials bike. It's a full, what they call a dirt bike, low and high gear ratio on it, and it's basically made for essentially doing tricks.
Yeah.
It's made for playing.
Stunts.
It's made for stunts, yeah. And that's about it, really.
Wheelie King on that one.
Yeah, the Wheelie King, yeah. As you can see, it's in good condition. It's got a good reserve of 1,000 to 2,000 on it, the estimate. So I reckon good things will come from that bike on Saturday. And overall, we know the vendor as well of this bike, and it has been well looked after, and it's been well maintained.
It looks like a lot of fun, that does, it really does. Yeah. Moving on to this rather lovely 1917, to over 100 years old, this bike. Look at this Humber. I mean, it's just a work of art, isn't it? I could just look at these First World War bikes all day, because they're so close in their architecture to the pedal cycles of the time, aren't they? You can see where the evolution came from.
You can, yeah.
It's like cars of the same period. You can see where they evolved from horseless carriages, effectively. Whereas these are just bikes with engines almost, aren't they?
Yeah, they're bikes with engines. You can see that. And you can also see through the ages, you've got that coffin-style tank that gave you a huge reach. And actually, the only reason for that was because of the fuel capacity and oil capacity you need to put in there.
Yeah.
And over years, you see the evolution of that getting shorter
and squatter.
And fatter and,
yeah.
And wider.
That happens to us all, love,
yeah. Yeah, well, that's what happens with age, unfortunately, isn't it? Yeah.
Now, this is eligible for the Banbury Run, and we should explain to people that are perhaps new to the biking world, like me,
yeah.
what the
yeah.
Banbury Run is. So this is kind of like the bike equivalent of the London to Brighton, almost, isn't it?
So it's a lovely little run that's done down south, just outside of London, where you get hundreds, potentially thousands of bikes of that era together, and everyone just goes out for a big knees up and rides around, and it's the dress for the era as
yeah.
well. Quite a lot of fun. And yeah, I mean, looking at the bike, there's a bit of rust on it. You mean, just look at those original.
I know, isn't it brilliant? But again, I think if you touch this bike, other than to service it, you should be shocked.
Yeah, you can't touch this. This needs to just be left alone because it's aged from new to look like it is now.
It's perfection, isn't it?
And it still works, so I don't think anyone should spoil it, you know.
No, it's just how it is and how it sits, to me, it's just flawless.
It's absolutely beautiful.
I love it. A work of art. And talking of work of art, a literal sculpture behind it. So, a wooden Harley Davidson.
Yeah.
So this is a bit of fun, isn't it?
Yeah, so these were built in Korea in like the 70s and 80s, and then they stopped doing production. And this one is a model of a Harley Davidson that was actually used in the Second World War. As you can see, it's got a gun there on the...
It actually has a wooden gun. Look, this is how authentic it is. There you go.
Yeah.
Look at that. Don't shoot no one.
Is it loaded?
No. I've took the bullets out. This is a bit of fun, isn't it? If you had this in your study or your office, wouldn't this be a great conversation piece in the boardroom? If you're anything to do with either Harleys or the bike world.
Yeah, it certainly would. Or even if you've got a commercial business, just to stick it in the hallway, the entranceway or something like that.
So,
yeah, I mean, it's quite impressive. And as Elliot's probably showing you there, the actual intricate details that's on it, you know, the gear selector actually works. And that the thin cut bamboo that they've used for the cables and stuff. It's a really nice example, and with an estimate of 500 to 1,000.
Do you know, I'm going to have a little bit on that, you know.
That's definitely going
to
sell.
Because I'm not allowed to have a motorbike. My missus expressly forbade it, but she didn't say anything about wooden ones.
No, well.
So there you go.
Yeah, as long as it doesn't leak.
See, it has leaked. A bit of sap's come out of the bottom there. Typical Harley.
So, yeah, well, that's it. It's usually the British bikes that do that. But actually,
And then, well, talking of which, how about a 1921 Triumph Model H?
Yeah.
What can you tell me about that, other than the fact, again, beautifully patinated and must never be restored?
Yeah, I mean, they're both sat there. You can probably see from the camera that they're both very much a similar design in the way that the coffin tanks, you've predominantly got a bicycle frame with a bottom-mounted engine, long coffin petrol tank, and also... Back in the day, all the panniers, all the storage, everything was just nice leather compartments, which you can see is corroded there, lovely, and it looks beautiful for its area. Original seat on this one as well, which is quite impressive.
Can you imagine? That would tell some tales, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
So this bike is 102 years old. Just get your head around that for a minute.
That's mental, isn't it? I was just going to rub it, but thinking about old.
No.
How many has been on
how
that?
How many bottoms have been on that? That's crazy, 102-year-old
nice
machine.
Horn there as well.
And it works, and it starts and runs, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah,
motor runs perfectly.
Yeah, it works. Yeah, both of these bikes run, start, crazy
to ride. And they're
like
everything exempt, aren't they? They're exempt from everything.
Yes, apart from being extremely technical to ride.
Yeah,
which would definitely not.
Would you give lessons if somebody bought this and needed a bit of? Because it's like crazy gear lever positions. It's not like riding a modern bike, is it?
It's not. No. And was you going to say, would I give someone lessons?
Yeah.
No, absolutely.
Well, I mean, what's going on here? What are all these?
So what you've got is advance and retard.
Yeah, I know which one you are.
So, yes, I'm advanced, of course. So before they came out with the choke, as we know it, this was effectively a modern choke of its era.
Amazing.
Which decides on how much the carb lets air in and how much fuel to put in on startup.
And is that the feed for the lump?
It is, yes, that's
incredible.
So that's your oil holder.
Yeah.
And then you pressurise that.
Not in any way dangerous
oil
at all.
Pumps. No, absolutely not.
No.
And then that pumps it straight into your carbide lamp, where you've got a naked flame.
What could go wrong?
Right next to the fuel.
Next to the massive oil, above a petrol tank.
Yeah.
What could go wrong? What could go wrong, eh? Amazingly, survive this long. That's fabulous. What do you reckon you could buy that for, then? Come on the day and bid at that. What do you think we'd take that home?
Well, I mean, the bike's worth about 13,000 to 15,000.
Yeah.
What's the estimate on that one? I think it was 9 to 11.
There you go.
So if you could get it from 9 to 11, like we said before, you stole it.
Yeah, natural fairness. Lovely. Moving on to this. So this is, we're getting into some very cool paddock bikes now, aren't we?
Yeah, yeah.
And this is great. So if you want something, a bit of paddock bike or tazzing around, this little semi-auto Honda Wave, low mileage, 109cc, it's pretty much like a new bike, that one. You could buy that for buttons, couldn't you?
For buttons, yeah. So that's come as part of a guy's collection that he's put through us. And actually, that is the newer version of the Honda Vision, which you can see on the left-hand side of it. 110cc scooter, full suspension all round, and like you say, semi-automatic gearbox.
Dead easy to ride those, aren't
they? Yeah. If you need a commuter or you just want something to have a bit of fun on, it's in great condition, as you can see, and it's a steal.
Or if you've got a very long drive at your house and you want to go and fetch the mail in the morning, there it is.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just take it to the end.
Yeah.
Now this next bike, which I do think, this to me is peak Honda scooter styling for me, so this Honda Vision. Yeah. This has pretty much lived its entire life as a paddock bike, hasn't it? This has lived in motorsport paddocks.
Yeah.
Done 12,000 miles chasing around for tyres and
so
bacon butties.
The vendor bought it in 88. It's seen one MOT. I don't know why, because it didn't see the road. And then it's been part of a race team all its life. So it's done 12,000 miles, like you say.
Yeah.
Whipping up and down the paddock and doing other bits.
That's probably delivered more bacon rolls than any other bike in this sale, don't you reckon?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So, yeah, and it's a bit, it's, you know, looking at that square, the square design of it, it's the iconic design of a Japanese scooter of its era.
I think it's fabulous, I really do. Yeah. But I think the prettiest bike, well, see, the two bikes we're about to look at next get my vote as just astonishing looking things. So the 61 Aerial Arrow, so someone's done an awful lot of restoration on this, and it's nearly finished, but it's just a case of just putting those final bits on, isn't it? Making the perfect restoration. So 90% of the hard work's been done, 250cc. So there's bits missing, you'll see as you look around this, but they're all in the box, aren't they?
Yeah, so the guy that imported this and has done all the restoration work, he's done 90%, he's broke the back of it, the motor's been done,
yeah,
and he's supplied us with a few boxes of all parts. This is going to take you a weekend or two to put together. All the bits are there, so it's pretty much like a jigsaw.
Yeah.
You will have to go away and source a few bits, but the majority of it's there, like I say. If you're doing it for the love and it takes you a couple of months to find the bits to fit to it and finish, that is an absolute belter. Finished, it's worth about 3.5 to 4. In its current state, it's worth about 1,500.
And there's no reserve anyway, so you can just bid away?
And it's a no reserve. It's had a lot of interest. We've had a few gentlemen come in to see it today. We've had a lot of inquiries online, and it's understandable because it's an import. And it is, it's not an expensive bike, but it's a rare bike.
It's very pretty, isn't it? Just a wonderful little fun thing to have or to own or to ride. And as you say, probably what, 2-3 weekends away from being a finished thing, isn't it?
That's right, yeah.
Like this, now this to me is my favourite thing. 1960 Rumi Formicino.
Yeah, how beautiful is
what
that?
What were they thinking of? Because whatever they were smoking back in 1960, they need to start smoking it again, don't they? Because
they definitely do.
That's mega.
Yeah, I mean, Rumi came along, you had your Lambrettas and your Vespas, which were dominating the market, and Rumi came along and thought, you know what, we're going to show you who's boss. They stuck a 125, 250 actually, that one, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. It's a 125, though.
125 version. They did do a 250. They put a 125 version in that, and a lot of the scooters were only 50 and 75cc.
So that is a flying machine.
Yeah, so it's really fast as far as a scooter goes.
Yeah.
But what they tried to do was they wanted to build something a little bit Ferrari, Pininfarini-esque.
Yeah.
So they came up with something that's a slightly different design.
But that tank and headlight pod, the way that all flows into it, that's one of the cleverest bits of design I've ever seen on any bike or scooter.
Yeah, it's beautiful, isn't it?
Someone needs to bring that back because that's an astonishing looking thing. It looks modern, doesn't it?
It's great, yeah, it does look modern. It's weird because you kind of don't know where the headstock begins and ends, and you don't know where the headlight sort of begins and ends. It's kind of integral. Really comfy little thing. Bike needs a recommission.
Yeah.
Imported by the current vendor 2 years ago, and then it just sat in his house as a little trophy piece because he'd always wanted to own one. Never commissioned it, never put it on the road, and never ran it.
So you can keep it in your collection, or you could be that lucky person that puts it back on the road. But talking about paddock bikes, you know, if you, I've just got back from Goodwood at the weekend. You know, if you're doing Revival and that was your paddock bike, that game over, isn't it? Game over for everyone else in the paddock.
Yeah.
If you've got that, if you're doing bacon runs at Revival in that, I just feel sorry for everyone else in the paddock because you've just won.
You're the champion.
You really are.
Hands down.
So this is obviously another very pretty 1960s bike, 64 Vespa 150. And that is, what a restoration on that. Someone has loved that, haven't they?
They have loved that. And I'm going to be honest, we've had quite a few Vespas and Lambrettas through, but we've never had one of this standard. This is actually ours, the cheapest estimate of any scooter that we've had in, and ironically it's probably the best in terms of its restoration work. And if you just look at the quality of the paint on that, it's absolutely tremendous.
So there's all new bearings, the wheels have been powder coated, full motor restoration, full chassis, all the plastics have been restored. Yep. The paint job is just next level, isn't it?
Yep.
New handlebars, levers and swishes, and then
period
a brand new set of tyres.
Yeah, period tyres on there as
Again, another bike you could not build for it, probably even half what it's going to get. You know, it's mad, isn't it?
No, and the current owner as well is selling this a few along with a few other pieces because he wants an original Escort Mexico, so he's selling a few bikes off to buy the car of his dreams. So we're hoping that this is going to do really well for him. And with it being a Piaggio as well, Piaggios are quite rare. He actually bought this off of the guy that completely restored it from the ground up, and then since then, it has run it. It does run, but it's just sat in his house as a showpiece.
I love it. Just so pretty. Again, just wonderful things to have a sort of set dressing in your home as well, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
Now, Triumph Tiger, very pretty little bike, 1962.
Beautiful.
From a collector's wonderful collection, this one.
Yeah.
So British Racing Green, never goes wrong. Again, wonderful restoration. Needs a recommission and a little service, but apart from that, it's been dry stored for a long time and it's looking very well for it, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. It's come from a collection of around 200 motorcycles that a guy has in a barn on his land.
Yeah.
And it was bought because of his love of Triumphs. He's never rode it. He's never ran it. And for that reason, it would need a recommission. However, as you can see, it's been completely restored and overhauled, motor, everything else, before he purchased it.
And 4.5 to 5.5 grand, so not a huge amount of money.
Nope.
And then we go forward 2 years to the same bike, two model years later. Are there massive changes between those two?
Not really, no. Both OHV valves, very similar types of induction on these two, slightly bigger on the later one on the carburetor. You can also see that on the newer version as well, we've got some slightly more sturdier uprated front forks, but other than that, they're pretty much the same. The blue one, as you can see, has got the original seat, whereas the green one has been replaced with something a little bit more modern.
What does the purist like? The purists tend to go for all original look, so the flatter seat, less support, but obviously.
Yeah, well, obviously the purists want the purists, but it doesn't always mean it's the best, does it?
That does look very nice. Again, this is a collection bike, is it? So this will need a service and recommission if you want to use it, or just tuck it in your collection.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, same, these two and the next, the Triumph Thunderbird, all from the same collector, from all purchased, thoroughly restored, put in his collection, never ran, and it's now time to
move them on for something else.
Exactly.
So these really are sort of no questions bikes, other than a service and recommission. You can either just look and admire with nothing to do,
Well,
I would imagine very minimal work to get that working as well. That Thunderbird, that's a pretty bike, isn't it?
It's a exactly. Bigger CC motor, more expensive machine. You can see it's a bit more muscular and bolstered, but in essence, same story as the other two. Sat in a collection. Nice and warm and dry, and again, ready to move on to a new owner.
So we say all these bikes need recommissioning, but just to clarify, they all start run, don't they? It's just a case of sort of brake servicing, new plugs, just to make sure they run and stop perfectly.
It's a case of checking oils, lubricants, seals, just making sure that they're safe. From a mechanical point of view, good to go.
Amazing. So then that moves us on to this 83 Bonneville. Now that is a good looking bike.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
So 750cc, but this is used regularly, so this is the other end of the scale. So this is one that's pretty much with two new tyres.
Yep.
It's got all the previous MOTs, great service history, runs really well, lovely and quiet and smooth.
Yep.
And the owner rode this one in.
He did, yeah, because I said, you know, does it run? And I said, no, it runs. I said, you know, it's okay if it doesn't, as long as you tell us.
Yeah.
So he said, well, where are you? And it turns out it was local. And he said, you know what, I'm going to ride it in just to prove that it works. And he did. And it runs great. It starts you know, great, no issues. The bike's been restored. It looks beautiful. It wants for nothing.
Yeah.
Just a bidder.
That's it. And a bidder with probably what, about sort of five and a half grand would buy that, you reckon?
Yeah. Yeah. Of course. Yeah. I mean, obviously, we'll see what she makes on the day. However, like you just alluded to, the estimate on that one is another low estimate.
Yeah, it's sensible, very sensible. So that's a 140, T140.
Yep.
That's a T140 V, 1977.
Yep.
What's the difference between a V and a 140? That's obviously an older bike, isn't it, that one?
It's an older bike, yeah. But all it is really is the V model was like their version of an S, so it's like the sports, if you like. Ooh. So just a few bits. Suspension, slightly bigger carburetor, and a few other fiddly bits and pieces, but in essence, pretty much the same motorcycle, and doesn't really affect the value. As you can see, I think they're both pretty much equally priced.
Lovely. And then it moves on to this 99 Thunderbird Sport. Now this is, if you're looking for one, like we say, if you're looking for one,
that
you're looking for that
so
one.
Good. That is so good.
So tell me why this is so good, because I can see from here it is so pretty, and the condition of every component is lovely. Does it ride as well as it looks?
It really does, yeah. It's just absolutely brilliant. And what I really like about this bike as well is, having met the vendor, he rides the TT every year. He's a very thorough guy. You can see he's a very transparent bloke. He even came in because he was concerned that he'd done a load of work to the bike to get it in the state that it's in terms of giving it a service, everything else, new tyres, and then felt that he should put a new battery on it. So he went and spent another 100-odd quid and actually
proper
brought
vendor.
The battery in and fitted it. So it's come from a proper bloke. It's a proper bike. It's well priced, and we're expecting good things from that.
So that'll be what, sort of about 426, you reckon, something like that?
Yeah, I mean, it's 6 to 7 grand's worth of machine. So.
Yeah. And that brings us to this, Jimmy. This is rather groovy, isn't it? And they did actually paint them like this in Pooh, but not quite the shade, was it?
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, it wasn't quite as orangey, and the blue wasn't quite as light.
Yeah.
And what the owner or the person who's restored this bike has done is what you do see on a few Triumph Cubs, and they make it into like a Gulf-style library.
Which I am feeling, I've got to be honest.
And what a beautiful job as well. Yeah. How good the paintwork is on it. It's fantastic.
Very, very nice.
Yeah, so I'm going to be quite bold and say that this is the cleanest and nicest, although be it's only a T20 club.
Yeah.
This is the nicest Triumph we've ever had come through our auction.
Great riding position as well, because for a little bike, you can fit a big lad on it, can't you?
Well, you're a big lad, aren't you?
Yeah.
In height wise.
I've got to say, I would like to have a little ride of that. That's very lovely.
Yeah.
What do you think that'll go for, Jimmy?
Well, we're not too sure. You know, I never like to put a price
on it. That's the joy of auctions.
You never know on the day.
No, you guys set the prices.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, it's got a low-end reserve on it, which has made it quite popular.
Yeah.
And just due to the nature and the quality that it's been restored at, the likelihood is that we should get a nice bid up on it.
Lovely.
I mean, you can just see the qualities and the level that this bike has been restored. It runs, it rides perfectly, the brakes are good, it's just been serviced, it's tax exempt, it's MOT exempt, it's just good to go. It can be stuck in a collection, or you can get it out on the road.
Yeah, or if you've got a nice Golf livery GT40 or GT40 replica, it'd look perfect in the garage.
It would, yeah.
So there you go, guys. That is our little bike walk around. Thank you for watching that. If you've got time, if you're watching these earlier, as you should be, because you've liked and subscribed, to do that now if you haven't and got the notifications clicked. You're going to be watching this on Wednesday night, which means you've still got Thursday, Friday and Saturday morning to come and view. He is the most knowledgeable bike man in the north. So if you'd like any questions answered, come and see him. He'll walk you around, answer all your questions. Make sure you've gone to manorparkclassics.com if you want to have a proper look at the lot listings, and make sure you've registered to bid. And even better, come and see us on Saturday the 22nd, because we'll both be here, and hopefully you will be too.